Okay. So today we are going to talk about Apache Log4j. Commonly just called as Log4j. What is my background in using this particular technology? To be honest, I don't have much of a background in Log4j. In fact, when I was a student some 20 years back, I used Java. More recently, in between maybe 2007 or 6, I used Java again for a little while. But after that, most of my programming is done in PHP and Node.js and JavaScript and Python, Perl. So these are the kind of languages I have been using more on a regular basis. So Java is not something I use, but I'm familiar with it. But I got interested in Log4j mainly because of the the Log4 shell bug that was discovered recently. And there has been a lot of talk in the industry about this particular bug and how many different systems, applications and packages it affects out there. So a lot of interesting news about this bug in the last couple of weeks. And I thought people would be interested to know more about Log4j. So I thought I'll schedule this talk. So don't see me as an expert in Log4j. I'm here mainly to introduce Log4j at an introductory level. This talk is mainly meant for beginners. Beginners who are working with Java probably have used a little bit of Log4j or never used it. So this talk is for that kind of an audience. But towards the end of the talk, we will talk about a little bit about the particular bug which has surfaced recently. And we can have a discussion around that. Some of you who are experts in Log4j, if you are on this call, you can contribute to the discussion towards the end. So I hope this sounds interesting. So let's get started. So the first thing is the question to be asked is, why do logging in an application? That's the basic question to ask. Most of us, when we started programming as a student, the way we look at or debug an application is via print statements. And we were always told, print statements is not the right way to debug an application, which is actually correct advice, because when you have a debugger at your disposal, when you can get deep insights into how the code actually executes, a debugger is a much better solution. So why would anyone then use a logging tool or a framework? So the answer is pretty much well known, because there is a difference between debugging and logging. So debugging typically is done when you have a problem at hand during the development process and you need human intervention. So you need to look into the internals of what's going on and stuff like that. So that is the typical purpose of debugging. But what happens if you hit an issue in production? Can you trace exactly the sequence of events which led to that particular problem? And when a particular problem arises in production, it will not be easy to replicate that problem in your development environment. In fact, you may not even know the conditions in which that problem surfaced, unless a customer calls customer support and gives a screenshot or shares exactly what happened. The customer support or the tech support team is going to be completely clueless. So this is where logging helps. Even if you don't get much information directly from the customer, you can look at your system logs, your application logs, whatever logs each of your components are generating. You can look at that and you can analyze exactly the stream of events which led to a particular problem. So that is where logging becomes very useful. And experienced developers, they can easily find out a problem simply by the logs. Whereas to do the same thing with debugging is less productive, because you have to do it step by step. You have to single step. You have to basically go through the same sequence of executions. Whereas in a logging method of debugging, you look at the logs, you study the code, and you reason it out. So there is a little bit more thinking involved in analyzing logs, but then it's more productive because you can get to the root of the problem quickly. Now, having said all this is possible only if you have done sufficient, the developers have put sufficient effort to log the right kind of things. Too much logging can be counterproductive because you have a flood of messages and you don't know which is going to be important. Too little logging can also be problematic because you don't have enough context to find out where the problem could have occurred. So the right amount of logging that an application has to have is not so much of a science. It's really something of an art. And if you are a developer, you need a lot of experience to know how much to log, what to log, and what kind of log messages will give you the right context. So these are all some things that only experienced developers know. But yeah, these are things that can be learned easily. So this is a brief like a comparison between debugging and logging. And the other thing about logging is, the typical architecture in logging is that, or the beauty of logging, most of the well-known loggers, they are designed in such a way that you don't have to rebuild your application to change the log, the amount of log that your application produces. So everything is managed through configuration files, which are external to the application. So without rebuilding or redeploying your application, you can change how much your application logs. So that is, a typically good logger or a logging framework will be designed in that particular way. It's not going to be hard-coded into the application code. So that's the kind of overview I wanted to share with you about logging and debugging. So let's look at specifically Log4j. Now Log4j has a history, so we'll briefly look at the history. So it started as a project in 1996, and in 1999 it became an Apache project. So until then it was something independent, but in 1999 it was an Apache project. And the version 1.0 was launched in January 2001. So that this is very relevant because at that time when Log4j was released, there were not that many loggers out in the market. So as a consequence, what happened was it kind of became a monopoly, and almost every Java developer started adopting Log4j for their logging requirements. Which is why Log4j became enormously popular through this decade, 2000s. And that is one of the reasons why we have a huge problem today on our hands, because the bug that was discovered 2-3 weeks back, the impact is widespread. And the reason can be traced to what happened in 2001, because at that time in 2001, there were not that many alternatives to Log4j. Which means that even today, a lot of the packages, not just legacy packages, even the newer packages which people are coming out with, they tend to use Log4j. So that is one of the reasons. Another major change in Log4j was in 2002 when version 1.2 was released. And version 1.2, a lot of patch releases and minor releases were happening. But finally, the Log4j community decided that in 2015, this will have an end of life. But then, in the same, in 2012, people started working on the version 2 of Log4j. So what we call today as Log4j is actually version 2. So remember that there are two versions of Log4j. One is the version 1, which was, which reached end of life in 2015. And then, Log4j 2.0 came out in July 2014. Now, this difference is important because 2.0 is not backward compatible with 1.0. There are major differences, and that's why today when we say Log4j, We universally mean 2.0 because we expect most people would have migrated their systems to from 1.x to 2.x. Even legacy systems should have migrated by now because 1.x is no longer maintained and it has a lot of limitations. Another important milestone is 2017 or about mid 2016 when it was discovered. So 17 Java 9 was released. So this is one of the earliest releases of Java 9, which breaks version 1.0 of log4j. That means if you are using Java 9 and future releases of Java, it is almost certain that you shouldn't be using version 1 of log4j. You should have already migrated to version 2 of log4j. So this is the brief history of log4j. Before we get into the architecture and stuff like that, let's have a demo. And after the demo, we can have a Q&A, and then we can go into the rest of the discussion. So I'm going to give you a simple demo here. I'll just increase the font a little bit. Okay. So I am using VS Code as the IDE. Many of you may be using Eclipse, which is a very good IDE. Then there is IntelliJ, that's also a good IDE. So there are lots of IDEs out there. I'm using VS Code. So I have configured VS Code for Java, and also in this particular sample project, I'm using Maven as the builder. So when we get started with log4j, obviously we have to configure the project with the necessary dependencies. So if you look at, so in a Maven project, the dependency file is pom.xml. And if you look at this particular file, it has all the high level information about the project. So in this example, the project is called com.example, and the main file is app.java. Okay, so this is what we have here, and what else? So some of the dependencies, JUnit, it is added as a dependency by default for unit testing. So if you create a typical Maven project, this dependency, it's automatically included in this configuration file. But two other dependencies which we have to add as developers to enable log4j are these two. One is the log4j API, the other is the log4j core. So all you need to do is modify this XML file with these two dependencies. And then if Maven, when you build it, Maven will automatically download these dependencies. So as you can see here on the left side, these dependencies have been downloaded. So here I have log4j API and then log4j core, and the versions are also displayed. So this is coming directly from what you have configured in the configuration file. Now, what kind of configurations are possible for log4j? So for log4j, we need a configuration file. So that file is what we call here log4j2.yml. So interestingly, log4j accepts configuration in many different formats. It can be YAML format, which we are using here. It can be .properties file. It can be a .xml file or a .json file. So different types of configuration formats are possible. But of course, YAML is most preferred because it's very terse, easy on the eyes, easy to maintain. So a lot of developers today prefer the YAML format. Notice the suffix here, 2, log4j2.yaml. So this is the like the convention, because remember I talked to you, we discussed about version 1 and version 2 of log4j. So this implies that this will be the file which will be picked up first, because anyway we are using version 2 of log4j. So this is the configuration file which will be automatically picked up by the system, by log4j. And where does this configuration file reside? So it resides under source main, and a subfolder called resources. You could also put it in test. That's also fine. Some people recommend that you put it under test. And there is a reason for that. We'll not get into it. Maybe later in Q&A, we can look into it. And then we can also configure. So obviously, this configuration file will tell you where to store your logs. So in this example, I have configured a variable log path and logs. And then when we are actually logging, this is the file name. So here it is logfile.log. So we'll call it system.log. And you will notice here, there is a system.log under the directory logs. So this configuration file determines where your logs are going to be stored. So one thing I wanted to show you here in the overall project configuration, there are two more dependencies which are important. And this is because the kind of format that we are using for the log4j. So the two dependencies are called Jackson data bind and Jackson data format YAML. The reason for that is log4j is not going to understand, or the Java system is not going to understand, the YAML configuration file we have provided unless you load these two dependencies to process the YAML file. This is not very well documented, actually. If you look at a lot of videos on YouTube or even blogs about how to configure log4j, this particular thing is not documented because they may be using an XML file or a .properties file. But if you start using a YAML file, it's essential that you configure these two dependencies as well. Okay. Now let's look at our application. Application is pretty simple. We have app.java. And what we have done here, we have configured, we have imported two things. From log4j, we imported logger and the log manager. So these are the only two things we have imported. Then in our class, when we are working with our class, we create a logger. So through the log manager, we get a logger, and to that logger, we pass a parameter app.class. So I will explain this a little later what this does. So then we get hold of the logger handle, and we use the handle to log a message. So we throw an error message saying, "Hello logger." This is a normal system printout, which we are used to doing for debugging. So this is like a printf in C, let's say. So this says "Hello world" as usual, but for logging, we say "Hello logger" here. So let's run this and see what happens. So it is running. Okay, so we have got the output here. The time is correct. So this is Indian time. So 1923, we have logged this message, error message, because that is what we gave here for our error level. Then the date, and then from which module or function it is being logged, what is the name of the file or the, I don't know what you call it in Java. And then the actual error message. So message is there along with relevant information to tell the developer where that message is coming from. Okay. So this is a brief overview of what is happening. Now let's go to the YAML configuration file, and let's try to make sense. We can't understand all of this right away, but some basic things we can understand. For example, there are two things happening. So I will discuss this in little detail later. But you see, there are many configurations here. One of the configuration is that we are logging it to a file. So let's look at let's open that file and see if this particular thing has been logged there. So as you can see here, this is the message we just logged. So the message is logged in two places. It is logged in the system.log file, as we have indicated here. And it is also coming to the console. So it is also coming here. So logging happens in two places. And the reason for that is, if you look at the configuration file here, there are two things which are specified. At the root level, we are saying that you log to the console, but at a specific logger level, we are saying you log to a file. And this file appender is defined here, and the console appender is defined here. So that is the reason the same message is logged in two places, one to the console and one to the file. Now it's possible that you can change the formatting. Suppose I change the formatting. I want to move this somewhere here. So I have changed the formatting the way it appears on the console, but I retain the old formatting for the file appender. Now if I run my application, what will happen? So we will notice that the same kind of logging happens, but the formatting is different. See, on the console, now the error message, the error tag has changed place, whereas in the system log, it remains in the same place. So the point I want to make is the configuration file or the entire log4j architecture provides you with a lot of flexibility. The way you want to log, the formatting can be changed, configuration can be changed, levels of debugging can be modified, and it need not be the same across the system. So at the file, when you are logging to a file, you can have a certain format. When you are logging to a console, you can have a different format. So all this flexibility is possible. So with this high level introduction, we'll have some Q&A before I move on. Any questions? Okay, if there are no questions, we can come back to Q&A later. Before we understand, there are of course a lot of other things in the log configuration. So now we'll try to make sense of these things. But before we can figure out what these things are, it's helpful to look at the log4j architecture. So in this architecture diagram, this will give us a lot of insight into how log4j actually works, and it will also help us make sense of the configuration file. So there is a logger here. Everything starts with a logger. And before looking at the logger, let's go back to our application. See, what is the first thing that we did? We took a log manager, and we called a method on the log manager called getLogger. And this returned us a logger object. So that is exactly what we are looking at here in the class diagram. So what we have obtained is a logger object. And using this logger object, we have been logging. Now this logger object is associated with a configuration file. And then there are other things attached to this. So there are some things called appender and some things called layout. So let's try to understand a little bit of each of this. So at this point, and then there is also something called logger context. So what happens is when you first create a logger, let's assume that the logger handle is created in multiple places. So this is one place where the logger handle is created, but obviously in a more complex application, you would want to do this logging from a number of files that make up your application. Now you don't want to log all of them in different places. Typically you want all the logs to go into one particular file, let's say. So how does the system know that let's say I am opening a logger here, whether this particular logger and let's say this is logged to a particular file system.log, and I am opening a similar logger in another file, how do I make sure that both the loggers log into the same system.log file? So that is where logger context comes into picture. So when we talk about logger context, that is one of the things. So when a logger is first created, it checks whether a similar logger is already in existence in the system. So if it is already in existence, that particular handle is returned to the caller. If it doesn't exist, then a new logger context is instantiated. And that logger context obviously is associated with the configuration. Now let's go back to the log configuration and understand some of these things. So what we have here is logger, and there are actually two loggers in our system that we have configured. One is the root logger, then the other is the logger which we are accessing in our application. Now when we instantiate this, when we configure this logger, we give it a particular name, com.example.app. Now this naming is very important, because when we call this logger here, instantiate this logger here, we are passing an argument called app.class. So what does this app.class translate to? It actually translates to, as you can see there, com.example.app. So that is the full name of the class. So when we say app.class, it translates to com.example.app. So this is the one that makes the link to this particular configuration. And once that link is made, then for this particular logger, this is the kind of log level that we should be using. And this is the appender. So what is the appender? It simply says where you have to log. So each appender is defined elsewhere within the file. So all the appenders are defined. So this is for console, this is for a file, and you can define many more, you know, and then you can use that definition here. So here I am saying I am appending, I am using the file appender, I am using the, and then I am, for the root I am doing this. Can I do this? Can I do console again? What will happen if I do this? Notice that now the same message is displayed twice in the console. Why is this happening? The reason this is happening is, at the root level, I have an appender which is logging to the console. At the logger level, I am having another appender which is also logging to the console. The end result is, on the console, the log messages appears twice. So of course this is not a valid use case, but I just wanted to point out that there is no restriction that a logger should have only one appender. A logger can have multiple appenders, and this is what is seen in the class diagram. As you can see in this class diagram, 0 to star, which means that you can have multiple appenders configured. Okay, then there is a question of layout. So layout is something like this. Already we have seen an example of layout. Layout is nothing but the way you want your messages to be logged. And all this percentages D and percentage level and all this stuff, it is kind of similar to the printf and scanf that we are used to seeing in C language or C++ language. So something similar is happening. Of course, the semantics are a bit different, but that is pretty much easy to learn. So when we talk about patterns here, this layouts that is shown here, this is really what we mean. Okay. Now let's look at log debugging, the log levels. So this is a very quick overview. Most of you may be familiar. So the system has different levels of logging: fatal, error, warning, information, debugging, tracing. So these are the different levels in which you can configure your loggers. Now when the loggers are configured in one of these levels, this has an impact also on what kind of events can be logged. So for example, when we create an event, when we log an event, that event also has an associated logging level. It can be all or off and everything in between. So let's take an example. Let's say the event is an info event, but you have configured your logger for error. That means when you have configured it for error, it typically means that, so you can read off from this table. If the logger is configured for error and you are logging an info, it means it will not get logged. So that is the way to read this chart. So when you say that, you know, my event is an info, and so info will get logged only in these particular cases when the, yeah, instead of explaining here, we can have a demo that will be easier to explain. So let's take an example. Right now we are logging an error. And then what is the log level? So the log level is debug. So let's read off the chart. So we are logging an error and the logging level is debug. So obviously it is going to get logged, okay? But let's say my logging level is debug, but the event is a trace, then it will not get logged. So that is what the interpretation is. So let's change our event to a trace. And then let's run this. You can see here, the logging did not happen. And we can also look at the system log. So this is an older timestamp. So the logging has not happened. Why? Because we are now logging a trace message, but our logger level is set to debug level. So this message obviously is not getting logged. So this is the way to use this table. And this gives you a lot of power, how to configure the system for logging. So any questions at this point? Okay, if there are no questions, we'll move on. We can come back later. So now a typical application will produce lots and lots of logs. And you know, all these logs are typically going to be in probably in text files. And it's going to be quite difficult to use a text editor like this and analyze these logs. Thankfully, to simplify the life of developers, there are a lot of tools out there which can load a log4j log and help you to go through the logs quickly, more efficiently rather. So one of the projects from Apache itself is the Apache Chainsaw. So this is a typical screenshot from Apache Chainsaw, which is commonly used to load a log4j log. And then you can analyze quite easily. And messages are color coded. An info message is in green, error message is in red, warnings are in yellow, and so on. So this helps you to kind of more easily find out what is the root of the problem. But Apache Chainsaw is definitely not the only logger out there, only log viewer out there. There are many of them out there, including some commercial softwares, which could be a lot more powerful. So the important thing is we don't need to look at the text log files directly. We will always be looking at the log files through a GUI like this, which will simplify our work of debugging the logs. Okay. So the last thing I want to share is before we go to Q&A, the last thing I want to share is log4j, because it was kind of launched at the right time, in the early, in 2001, when logging was not such a big thing in those days. So log4j has inspired many other logging solutions, and log4j itself has different ports. So earlier, Gopi Padmanabhan mentioned, .NET has a variant. Yes, Log4j has been ported to .NET as well. But within the Java world itself, there are many variants of Java. So we have Scala, we have Android, we have Kotlin. Then we have Groovy, that's another language inspired by Java. What else? We have one more language called Clojure. So that's also inspired by Java. So all these languages have some sort of either a port of Log4j for their systems, or they have an adapter that they can call the Log4j APIs. So all this is possible. So the Log4j has a wide impact on many languages. One more thing I want to share is related to this particular questions. What does it mean to say that Log4j is an API? Now, I have not written the answers for any of these questions because this article is still work in progress. Hopefully, it will be published in a couple of days. So I want to close my inputs with this particular question. So what does it mean that Log4j is an API? So if you go through the many of the blogs, a lot of people will recommend an alternative called SLF4j, which they feel is a better option to Log4j. But that is not the only way to do it. Within Log4j, you can use Log4j kind of an API in all your apps. And there, Log4j provides you with an adapter whereby any API call to Log4j will be translated to SLF4j calls. So you can use SLF4j in your application to do all the logging, but you can call Log4j APIs in your application. So that is one thing I wanted to share. Then the second thing why this API is important is what if you are developing a library? So when you are developing a library, you don't specify as a library developer exactly what kind of implementation you want to use for your logging. So the implementation will be decided by the app developer who is going to use your library. So when you are writing a library, you are not going to give a concrete implementation of Log4j classes. Instead, all your library functions are going to call an API. But behind that API, the implementation is going to be provided by whoever is going to develop the application according to their entire ecosystem of logging. So that is why the concept of API is important. So when your library is calling Log4j API, it is simply saying that it is going to be interoperable with any app that is going to provide an equivalent implementation of that same API. So that is all we are saying here. So it is important to understand that difference. So of course, this matters more to library developers. It matters less to app developers. If you are an app developer, you may not even care that Log4j provides an API because you may be looking at the concrete classes, the concrete implementations. Okay, so this is what I had to share. Any Q&A, we can do that now.
Yeah, in the Java world, it is called Service Provider API and then
Yeah.
Developer API.
Okay. Thanks for that. Yeah.
And then other one is a log level. You said com dot, abc dot package name, right? Com dot
Yeah.
abc dot cd. Yeah.
Yeah.
See, they are meant for log level to be controlled at every package level. Like
Yeah.
you said, if somebody wants root level, it has to override all of them. Then you do it at a com level.
Yeah. Yeah.
Otherwise, at a lower level, if you want to control, you only say com dot abc. Then make it debug level.
Yeah.
Others keep it at whatever is the root level.
Okay, yes. That is a good useful information, yes. So in this context, I want to share something. So let's go back to our configuration file. So logger and root. So one thing we want to keep in mind is that this logger actually inherits from the root. So these are not, logger is not completely independent of the implementation behind the root. So there is a class hierarchy here. So what we need to understand is logging classes also have a hierarchy. So this is a derived class of root. And if you don't define this, it basically means that this is going to get inherit the same logging level that is configured in the root. That is what it means.
And the patterns of logging is actually inspired by server logging, so that you know analytics can happen. Like that's what you said, log viewer. There are some server logging standards are there.
Yeah.
As per that, you know, that format is defined, patterns are predefined.
When you say standards are there, that means is it like industry best practice or really someone has defined a standard?
Yes, there is a standard for every, you know, how the HTTP server is supposed to log, so that the monitoring, observability, traceability are easy.
No, that I thought that is specific to web app, no? But log4j is beyond web app. Web app is just one of the uses of log4j. I can design a standalone app that will have its own way of logging.
Right, the format of logging. Yeah. Like, for example, you know, yeah, you give the class name, you know,
yeah.
How do you give the timestamp? In what order you do it?
Yeah, I understand that. My question was, is there a standard or is it like a best practice in the industry?
There
when
is
I
a
say
standard,
I mean to say HCI standardized or I don't know.
W3 standard for HTTP servers. I mean, any server, yeah, I'm just saying HTTP server logging standards if you search.
Okay.
So that's based on that only these viewers will work.
Okay. Yeah, got it. I understood, yeah. Any other questions or comments? So we look at the zero-day exploit. Many of you would have read about it. So what I'm going to show you is basically this image. This image is produced by the Swiss government computer emergency response team. Okay. So there are, of course, lots of images out there, including videos to explain this, but I think this image suffices for our purpose. So in log4j, you are actually logging stuff. And this is an example of a web app. So an attacker is a client. He is making a HTTP request to the vulnerable server. And this server obviously is running a Java application and it is logging using log4j. Now in a web application, you not only log maybe the request and the response, but you are also logging a lot of things from the HTTP headers. So an example shown here is you are logging the header field user agent. Now the hacker can, you know, like inject any content in any of these fields I mean there are many fields which are liable to be hacked, and the server will accept it because the content of those fields may not be so important for the server to reject that particular request. So here, you know, the attacker has thrown in something into a user agent. And it's a particular call called JNDI, which is, I think, Java, I don't know, some of you may be aware. Basically, it enables you to look up a LDAP server, directory service. So what happens is, anyway, the server is going to log the message. And in the vulnerable log4j implementation, what it is going to do is it looks at this particular message and sees that this needs an external call to the LDAP directory. So this is where one of the main vulnerabilities. So this is going to make an external call to translate this particular URL to whatever this service is going to return. Now the attacker is of course smart. He has crafted this to point to his evil service, and that evil service is going to return a response which contains malicious code. So when this code comes as a response to our log4j system and the server, it is going to take that response and execute that malicious code, and that's where the entire thing collapses. So it's as simple as this. Is like this is what they call zero day vulnerability, where you can execute arbitrary code in your system, which means that it's easy for somebody to get any code that they desire and execute it on your system. So this is what the whole bug is all about. And I think few versions back, they introduced this feature where log4j can automatically look up an external service, get back the response and process that response. So obviously, you know, if your logging system is simple, you can say you can expect it to be more secure. If your logging system is complex and powerful, you can expect it to be less secure. So this is exactly what has happened here. But now what the log4j is recommending, or they are going to do, is in the next version, this automatic lookup is going to be disabled forever. I don't know, something like that. Any thoughts or comments on this? So what is surprising is it's an open source project. So many people are working on this, but for so many years, no one has kind of detected this particular problem until now, which means that we have to ask ourselves how many open source projects out there have problems. So this goes completely against what Linus Torvalds often quotes. You know, what he quotes is that, you know, so many pairs of eyes are looking at your code, so your code is going to be highly secure. So this is an example where that is not necessarily true or not always true. And the reason for that is today so much open source code is out there. Every open source developer is developing his own or her own package. So how much time do we get to look at or review the code produced by others? Any thoughts, comments?
Yeah, this log4shell is, you know, similar to SQL injection issue, where, you know, in the command, whenever we pass it to database, you know, some string, SQL string to execute. Similarly, during login, if you pass that, and if that happens to be, you know, executable, then log4j was actually executing that.
Yeah. But the thing about the SQL injection is, the problem happens through the database. Like you can wipe out the database and stuff like that. But here you are dealing it at the level of the application. You are injecting malicious code, which is much more harmful, because in SQL injection, for example, I don't think you can do a data theft. You can't export the data and steal data. Whereas when you execute malicious code, data theft is also possible. You are not deleting the data, but you can steal it.
Yeah, basically, yeah, you can actually have access to remote shell.
Yeah, so it's much more harmful than SQL injection.